Well, good morning. Welcome to Faith Community Church of the Nazarene. It's good to see you all this morning. I trust that you all had a good week and that you picked up a bulletin on your way in. If not, now's your chance. Run out there real quick. Couple quick announcements. I wanted to point out our Wednesday night activities. Each Wednesday night at about 6:45, we've been gathering here in the sanctuary for a time of prayer. So I would encourage you, if you have some time, it's not extremely long. You're not obligated to pray, but we encourage it. I would encourage you to make some time to come and join us for prayer. And also, this Wednesday is the first Wednesday of the month, and that means we'll be having teen group. So teens, Wednesday night, 7 o'clock, be here. This coming Saturday, November 5th, is men's breakfast. This is your warning, guys. This is your reminder. Set your calendars or clocks or whatever it may be. 8 o'clock here at church. I'll have breakfast ready for you. And then November 20th, Thanksgiving is coming up, I know. In just a few weeks, we'll be preparing for Thanksgiving. And this year, the community Thanksgiving service will once again be held right here at our church, 7 p.m., on November 20th, we will be having Thanksgiving service here, followed by pie and praise, and you don't want to miss that. There will be lots of good pie. And if you want to donate pies, we want to eat them. So, and we love pie. I also wanted to point out a lot of stuff happening November 20th. You guys should have one of these in your bulletins. Every year, at Thanksgiving, we take a special offering. It's the offering for World Evangelism Fund. And what that fund does is it's a fund as a part of the Church of the Nazarene to help spread the gospel across the world. And this Thanksgiving, we have an opportunity to give to that, to help spread the good news of Jesus to people who may not know otherwise. So I would encourage you, be thinking about that, be praying about it, and asking God how you can be a part. And finally, my last announcement. You guys may have noticed these in your bulletin last week. They're there once again this week. There are some in every row. These are our visitor connection cards. And if you are a visitor this morning, I would encourage you, there are pencils in front of you, go ahead and fill all that out. And if you're not a visitor, or even if you are, on the back we have a place for prayer. We believe in the power of prayer, and we want to be known as a praying church. And so if you have prayer requests, I would encourage you, fill out your prayer request, toss it in the offering plate, fill out the front information, toss it in the offering plate, and we'll be praying for you. We'll be praying with you. And if you don't have any prayer requests, if you're not a visitor, I would still encourage you, toss this in the offering plate, because we don't want to be wasteful of God's resources. And it's just a few pennies, but every penny counts. And so we want to reuse these. So if you have a prayer request or you're a visitor, please fill it out, and everybody toss them in the offering plates as they go by. That is all the announcements I have. So at this time, if our ushers will come forward, we'll receive the morning tithes and offerings.
Oh,
Father, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for your glory and your splendor. We thank you for your majesty. That, Lord, you are so high above us, and yet you look down on us with love and compassion. Thank you, Lord, for your vast and infinite love for us. Lord, I lift up to you those who are burdened. I pray for the Lorenz family as they're dealing with all the ramifications and everything that has come from this accident. Lord, I pray that you would give them quick healing. And Lord, I pray that you will help them in their time of loss. May you wrap them in your love. When the dark thoughts come and they feel weighed down with grief, Lord, I pray that you would be there in those dark times, that you would comfort them and that you would lift them up. Lord, I continue to pray for baby Drew. Lord, that you would help her to grow, that you would help her to become strong. Lord, that you would be with that family as they're taking care of this little one now. Lord, I pray that you would give them the strength that they need. I lift up Eric to you as well, as he's preparing for surgery. Lord, I pray that you give the doctors wisdom, that you give them insight into what's going on in his body. Lord, I pray for a complete healing. However you choose to do it, Lord, I pray that you take care of him. I also lift up baby Naomi to you. She's been born way earlier than intended. Lord, I pray that you would touch her little body, that you would help her to grow, that you would help her to do everything that she needs. Lord, I pray for the parents as they're going through these trials, as they're having to watch their baby struggle for life. Lord, I pray that you give them strength. That on those days when things are looking bleak, when things aren't going perfectly well as they had the day before, Lord, I pray that you would lift them up, that you'd give them the strength to carry on, and that you would show them your love and your mercy. Lord, I pray for those who are struggling this morning, for those facing family problems or financial problems. Lord, I pray for those who are struggling with their faith, who don't know where to turn. Lord, many people in our society question whether you are truly out there. Lord, I pray that you would make yourself real to them. Lord, that they would know that you are God, that you are who you say you are, and that they would know the great love that you have for them. Lord, be with us this morning. Guide our hearts, open our minds, as we seek to learn more about you. I pray this all, Lord, in your precious and holy name. Amen. As a pastor, I tend to run in some fairly religious circles. I have pastor friends who I went to college with, that I speak with on a regular basis. I have pastor mentors who have been pastoring for decades who I speak with. I'm even a part of some online groups that are Nazarene pastors and just pastors in the area. Lots of different pastors converse with me on a regular basis. And with so many groups of pastors, the topic of the good old days tends to surface every so often. It used to be that in the good old days, everybody went to church. It's just what people did. A pastor's job, while it was to preach the gospel and to let people know of Jesus, one of the main functions was just to make sure that all the programs ran smoothly. It was a given that people would come into your church and you needed to be prepared for them when they did come. In those days, the Bible says so carried a lot of weight. However, those good old days are gone. I was reading an article the other day that addressed this very topic. How the Bible says so doesn't hold the same sway that it used to. In our modern society, people don't hold the Bible in the same regard as they did in the good old days. as such, we as Christians, if we are to fulfill the Great Commission, if we are to make disciples, if we are going to convince our society to follow Christ, we must do so on their level. We can't point to the Bible as the Word of God until we've convinced them that it is the Word of God. Our current apologetic series is looking to do just that. Through the tools of this world, through science, logic, and rationalism, we are seeking to demonstrate that God is who He says He is, whether you choose to believe it or not. And up to this point, we've discussed whether or not truth really does exist. We've talked about some evidence for a theistic God. And as we continue into part two of the question, does God exist? We'll be looking at even more evidence. As I stated last week, what we're looking at with the question, does God exist? There are lots of different pieces of evidence, but we are looking at three in particular, two scientific ones and one philosophical. Last week, we looked at the cosmological argument that said, since there was a beginning, there must be a beginner. Before I go any further, I must give credit where credit is due. A lot of the information that I have that I have learned, I have gleaned from men way smarter than I. And a lot of it came from the book, I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist, by Norman Geisler and Frank Turek. In addition, I've relied upon the knowledge and research of Dr. William Lane Craig, Dr. Ravi Zacharias, and Dr. John Lennox. I would encourage you, if you want more information, Google their names, their websites, their Facebook page, their YouTube channel. All of that will come up, and there's lots of good information. But as we begin to look at the teleological argument, I know that's a $6 word, but this argument is an argument from design. And to begin this, we begin with a walk. Say you're taking a hike through the woods. It's the first day of deer season. You're out there going to your stand or however you choose to hunt. And as you're walking along, there's nobody around for miles. And down on the ground, you see a diamond-studded Rolex. Now, as you look at this watch, if you found this watch on the ground, would you think that it was made by natural causes? Would you think, when you picked this watch up, oh, well, the wind and the rain just came by in the right way and made this watch. I don't need to turn this in. It obviously was just created by nature. No, as you look at that watch, you understand that behind every watch is a watchmaker. It turns out that the universe and life are much more designed than a watch. We just finished talking about how the universe came into existence out of nothing. And so we'll start right there. As we showed last week, even atheistic scientists agree that everything in the universe, space, time, and matter, all came into existence out of nothing in an event that is commonly referred to as the Big Bang. As we will see, not only did everything explode into existence out of nothing, it did so with extreme precision. This is called the anthropic principle. It comes from the Greek word anthropos, meaning human. It observes that the universe appears to be highly fine-tuned for human life to exist here on Earth, or even to exist at all. Stephen Hawking, British theoretical physicist, states that if the expansion rate of the universe was different by one part in 1,000,000,000,000, a second after the Big Bang, the universe would have collapsed back on itself or never developed galaxies. If you change the expansion rate of the universe by that minuscule amount, we wouldn't be here. Not only is it the expansion rate, but the force of gravity itself. If the gravitational force in the universe was changed by one part in 10 to the 40, the sun would not exist, the moon would crash into Earth or shear off into space. That is extreme precision. One part in 10 to the 40. It's kind of difficult to get your head around that number. That's a pretty big number. That is a 10 or a 1 followed by 40 zeros. If I were to try and write it up here, it wouldn't even fit. To give you an idea of the magnitude of 10 to the 40, we'll take a look at the Midwest. We're all familiar with the Midwest, or at least we should be. The total land area of the Midwest is 821,732 square miles. Now, if we were to take dimes and we were to stack them across the entire area of the Midwest, and we were to stack them, let's say, all the way up to the sun, that's quite a ways away, we would have 7 times 10 to the 28 dimes. That's not even close to our 10 to the 40 number that we need. A little math trivia here. What does it take to go from 10 to the 28 to 10 to the 29? How much bigger is that number? Anybody do well in math here? One more zero. That is 10 times bigger. To go 2 more zeros, to go from 28 to 30, that is 100 times bigger. So maybe we're thinking too small here. If we want to get to our 10 to the 40 number, I think we're going to have to up our game. And if we look at not just the Midwest, but the entire United States, with a surface area of 3.7 million square miles, and I don't think the sun is quite far enough. So we're going to stack these dimes up, not just to the sun, but to the closest star besides the sun, which is Alpha Centauri, approximately 4.3 light years away. That's quite a ways. Now, if we were to stack up dimes across the entire area of the United States, 3 million square miles, all the way up to Alpha Centauri, 4.7 light years away, we would still only have 2 times 10 to the 34 dimes. We still need 6 more zeros. We need a number a million times bigger than that. Can you imagine trying to find a single dime in that stack? That would be 1 in 10 to the 34. And we're looking at a million times more dimes than that. Let's imagine it another way. Imagine, if you will, that we took a tape measure and that we stretched it across the entire known universe, past all the stars and galaxies that way, past all the stars and galaxies that way, to the extent of what we know the universe to be. That is a long, long way, in case you were wondering. Now imagine, if you will, that across that entire tape measure, the force of gravity was set at a particular inch mark. I know gravity is not measured in inches, but this just gives you a scale reference. If we were to move the force of gravity 1 inch in either direction, we wouldn't be here. That's how precisely tuned this universe is. Now, there are only 3 possibilities for that force of gravity being right there. The first one is physical necessity. It had to be there. Scientists have discovered it didn't have to be there. It could have been here. It could have been there. It could have been 1,000 miles that way. Gravity didn't need to be right there. The second possibility is chance, that randomly it just happened to be there. When scientists use the word chance, it's really just a fancy word for saying we don't know. I don't have enough faith to believe that you could find the one dime in 10 to the 40. The third possibility is design. Somebody put it there. Once again, science doesn't say anything. Scientists do. We need to look at the evidence and come up with a reasonable explanation. Besides just the galaxy and the universe, there's a habitability argument in regards to our planet. Here's our solar system. Another little piece of trivia. Where are we in this? Third rock from the sun. You are here. Give her a gold star. We live in what scientists refer to as the Goldilocks zone. It is not too hot. It is not too cold. It is just right. If we were a little bit closer to the sun, we'd burn up. If we were a little bit farther away, we would freeze. In fact, the axial tilt of the Earth, 23.5 degrees. Change that slightly, we wouldn't be here. The Earth's rotation, 24 hours. Change that slightly, we wouldn't be here. The size and distance of the moon from us, change that slightly, and we wouldn't be here. If Jupiter wasn't in its current orbit, we wouldn't be here. Why is that? What does Jupiter do for us? Jupiter serves as a cosmic vacuum cleaner. It is so big, its gravitational pull is so strong that it pulls most of the asteroids and space debris towards it rather than us. Saturn does much of the same thing. If you look closely at Jupiter, you see those spots? Those are impacts from comet fragments that are larger than the Earth. Thank God for Jupiter. I mean, we tend to think that we're big stuff here, driving around in our cars, making all our money in our houses, and we're nothing. I mean, just look at our solar system. I mean, there's little Earth right there compared to massive Jupiter. Take it a step farther and compare it to our sun. I mean, there's Earth. You can, even if you don't consider Pluto a planet, you can barely see it up there. And just looking within our galaxy, these are stars just within our galaxy. There's our sun next to Sirius. Jupiter's one pixel in size. There's our sun. Again, these are just stars in our galaxy alone. The sun is one pixel. Jupiter and Earth completely invisible. I mean, to give you a scale, if the Earth were the size of a ping pong ball, this star right here, Betelgeuse, would be 6 Empire State Buildings tall. The heavens are awesome. Another anthropic principle states that the average distance between stars in our galaxy is 30 trillion miles. And it needs to be that way. Otherwise, the gravitational pull from other stars would pull us out of orbit. I mean, 30 trillion miles. How far is that? It's far, to put it simply. The space shuttle, as it orbits the Earth, or used to, I think there's still some guys out there now, travels at around 18,000 miles per hour. That is 5 miles per second. If you have trouble getting to work in the morning, take the space shuttle, you'll have no problem. But if we were to travel at that speed, at 5 miles per second, to the nearest star, an average of 30 trillion miles away, it would take us 201,450 years. If you hopped in the space shuttle at the time of Christ and started traveling to the nearest star, an average of 30 trillion miles away, you would barely be a hundredth of the way there right now. The heavens are awesome. According to scientists, the number of stars that are out there are equivalent to the number of grains of sand on all the beaches on all the Earth. and to go from one star to another, traveling at 5 miles per second, would take over 200,000 years. In Isaiah chapter 40, God is speaking, and he says, "To whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal?" Saying, do you want to know how big I am? It says, lift your eyes and look at the heavens. Who created all these? He who brings out the starry hosts one by one and calls them each by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. Do you want to know who God is? Many Christians have the wrong idea of God. We think of God as some big angel. God is not some big angel. If you want to know who God is, remove all limits from your mind. That's God. If he's an ounce of any attribute, he's infinite in that attribute. If he's an ounce of love, he's infinite in love. If he's an ounce of justice, he's infinite in justice. He is the unchangeable standard by which everything is measured. Psalm 103:11 says, "For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him." How high are the heavens above the earth? Stars as numerous as the grains of sand on all the beaches on all the earth. 200,000 years traveling from one to another at 5 miles per second. From our perspective, infinite. And that's the point. Not only can we get a sense of design by looking through a telescope, we can also get a sense of the design of this world by looking through a microscope. To see elements of design, we need look no further than a single-celled amoeba, something that Darwinists say that we evolved from, or at least something like it. Have you heard of from the goo to you via the zoo? This is the goo. Now, an amoeba, if you look closely, it does not say on it, made by God or made by natural forces. We need to look at the evidence to determine where these things came from. In Darwin's day, before they unlocked the cell, an amoeba didn't seem like any big deal. It was thought that maybe non-living chemicals could come together and form new life. From that point, natural selection takes over, and given a few billion years, here we are. Today, however, we know that a cell is not quite so simple. In order to show what we mean by that, we need to look no further than our breakfast table. Who here likes alphabet cereal? We got one. Two people like alphabet cereal. Good thing I haven't seen it stocked at Bronson's. Now, suppose you come down in the morning to the breakfast table and you see the box of alphabets spilled all over the table. And in that jumble of letters, you see written, "Take out the garbage, Mom." Now, would you think that this message occurred by accident? Would you think that there was an earthquake that shook the house and knocked it over and it just happened to form those combination of letters? No. You understand that a message needs a mind behind it. Suppose you're walking out on the beach and you see written in the sand, "Tom loves Shelley." Now, is your first thought that, oh, well, the crabs came out on the beach and they wrote that in the sand? Are you thinking that, well, the waves lapped up just right and made that message? No, you're going to say that Tom or Shelley or some intelligent being was involved in that message. And if simple messages like "take out the garbage, Mom" requires an intelligence behind it, then what about the message found in our DNA? DNA is the four-letter genetic alphabet that all living things have. I have DNA. You have DNA. Heck, a banana has DNA. And the human genome is 3 billion letters long. And all of it is in the right order to make you, you. How did it get that way? Microsoft founder Bill Gates, who is not a Christian, says, DNA is like a computer program, but far, far more advanced than any software ever created. People say that random mutations can account for the complexity of our DNA. First off, you need a functional code to get the whole thing started anyway. But second, if say that we did have somewhere to start, if you started randomly adding and changing the code in Microsoft Office, how well do you think that would work? I mean, it barely works now. If a message like, take out the garbage, mom, requires an intelligence behind it, what about DNA? I mean, they're essentially the same thing. In fact, how much DNA is contained within a single amoeba? I mean, we can line up hundreds of them within an inch. This is where Darwinists think we evolved from. According to renowned atheist Richard Dawkins, who being an atheist obviously isn't a Christian, the amount of information contained within a single amoeba is equivalent to 1,000 volumes of an encyclopedia. It seems that the first life requires an intelligent cause. Surely some will look at this claim and call it a God of the gaps argument, where we don't have an explanation, so we just plug God in there to fill the gap. They'll insist that we will find a natural cause for the beginning of life one day. And that's fine. We can keep looking. But this is not a God of the gaps argument. We aren't arguing from what we don't know. We are arguing from what we do know. When you see, take out the garbage, mom, it's not just that we lack a natural explanation for how it got there. Take out the garbage, mom, is positively, empirically verifiable evidence for an intelligent being. And when you see the message in DNA, it should tell you that there is an intelligent being behind it. To believe that the DNA, that the information contained within a single amoeba came together by chance, is like saying that the Library of Congress came together as the result of an explosion in a printing shop. I don't have enough faith to believe that. We've looked at the cosmological argument, that the universe had a beginning and needs a beginner. We've looked at the teleological argument, that the universe was designed and therefore needs a designer. Next, we will look at the moral argument. The moral argument says that if there is one thing out there that is objectively morally wrong in this world, then there must be a God. Why? Because for there to be an objective moral law, there must be a law giver. Now, I love Renee. When you're married to somebody, as you know, you tend to put up with each other's quirks. She puts up with my technophilia, my love for new technology and devices. She puts up with my crazy philosophical discussions I like to try and pull her into. And on the other hand, I endure her love for sappy novels, for World War II era history and documentary and stories, particularly the Holocaust. We've all heard of the atrocities that happened in those times. Jews taken to concentration camps, stripped of everything, and ultimately killed. In April 1945, the Allies liberated the Buchenwald concentration camp near Weimar, Germany. They went through the front gates, and to the right they saw the crematorium. As they journeyed toward the crematorium, they looked into the courtyard attached to the crematorium. And this is what they saw. Brace yourselves. If there is no God, this is just a matter of opinion. We all understand that the events that took place are objectively, morally wrong. It's not just a matter of opinion. It's not your opinion versus Hitler's opinion. If that's the case, then there must be a source, an authoritative moral standard beyond humanity that establishes this as being wrong. And that's what we mean by God's nature. How do we know who's right and who's wrong? When we compare Mother Teresa and Hitler, how do we know which one is better? For that matter, how do we know that anything is better? I mean, if I were to show you two maps of Scotland and I were to ask you which one is better, how are you going to know? How are you going to know which one of these is a better map of Scotland? In order to tell, you would have to see a real, unchanging place called Scotland to which we can compare them. If there is no Scotland, it's just a matter of opinion. Which one do you like better? We can't say that one is better than the other because we have no standard, but if we have a real, unchanging place called Scotland, we can compare them to the standard, and we can say that A, while it's not perfect, is a better representation of the real, unchanging Scotland. In order to determine which is better, you must have a standard of which to measure them. You must have a best in order to determine which is better. We do the same when we compare Mother Teresa and Hitler. Mother Teresa was not the standard. Hitler was not the standard. There is a standard beyond them by which we measure both of them. When we say that Mother Teresa was a better person than Hitler, what we're saying is she measured up to the standard better than Hitler did. If the standard didn't exist, well, then it's nothing more than a matter of opinion. Just like the map of Scotland. It's just which one do you like better? Do you like someone who helps the poor or kills the Jews? See, if there is no God, then what the Nazis did wasn't really wrong. Atheists will disagree. They'll say that, well, we look at it from our perspective and we see that it is wrong. They'll say the majority gets to decide what is right. Well, if that's the case, then the people in Germany, the majority that decided that it was right to kill the Jews, well, then they were morally right by that standard. In fact, in atheism, there really is no morality. Everything is just a matter of opinion. I mean, who says the majority gets to decide? In a lot of places, it's whoever is in control, whoever has the power, gets to decide what's right and wrong. They get to enforce their relativistic will on everybody else. There's no standard beyond humanity to say what is best. We're just molecules in motion. If there is no God, there are no human rights. Our Declaration of Independence states that all men are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. If there is no Creator, where do these rights come from? They're just a matter of opinion. So-and-so thought that we all should have these rights. Someone else may think differently. I mean, Martin Luther King then didn't do anything good because there was no standard of best. In fact, if you look at history, he was going against the cultural norm. And if the majority gets to make the rules, well, then technically he was wrong because he was going against the consensus of the majority. It's all just a matter of opinion. If there is no God, then tolerance is no better than intolerance. If there's one constant in our culture today, it's this idea of tolerance. However, you'll find that many of the people screaming for tolerance are some of the most intolerant people in the world. By the way, are Christians called to be tolerant? Are we commanded to be tolerant? No. We are commanded to be loving. Tolerance says, I will hold my nose and I will put up with it. Love says, I will reach out and I will help them. In order to love somebody, quite frequently, you can't tolerate the evil that they are doing. In fact, if you tolerate evil, you're unloving. In order to show love, you must have the courage to stand for the truth, even if people won't like you for it. If there is no God, then the religious crusades weren't wrong. Christopher Hitchens wrote a book titled, God is Not Great, How Religion Poisons Everything. And in his book, he talked about the atrocities of the religious crusades. And he's right. There were lots of terrible things that happened. Many of the people may have had good intentions, but a lot of bad things took place. However, as stated earlier, in atheism, there is no right or wrong. It's all just a matter of opinion. I mean, what's wrong with the religious crusades if there is no God? You can say you don't like it, but without a standard of best, you can't determine if it's right or wrong. Finally, you can't complain about the problem of evil if there is no God. It's commonly thought that evil disproves God. Most philosophers know that that can't be the case. C.S. Lewis, a former atheist turned theist turned Christian, believed that evil disproved God until one day he had an epiphany. He believed that there was too much injustice in the world for God to exist. In his book, Mere Christianity, he writes, as an atheist, my argument against God was that the universe seemed so cruel and unjust. But how did I get this idea of just and unjust? A man does not call a line crooked unless he has some idea of a straight line. What was I comparing this universe with when I called it unjust? So you can't know injustice without first knowing justice. You can't know evil unless there is good. And there would be no such thing as evil unless good existed. And good does not exist without an unchanging objective moral standard, an unchanging moral law. And an unchanging objective moral law does not exist without a lawgiver. Now, listen to what I'm saying. I am not saying that atheists can't be moral. They most certainly can. I am not saying that atheists can't know morality. They obviously do. But there's a difference between knowing what's right and knowing why it's right. Atheists can't justify morality. They can theorize how they know that murder is wrong, whether it's by evolution, whether it's by society, whatever means they got to knowing that it's wrong. But atheism provides no immaterial objective standard that establishes why murder is wrong. This is the difference between epistemology, knowing or how you know something, and ontology, that something exists. In this discussion of atheism and morality, people tend to confuse the two things. Just because you know right from wrong doesn't mean that a standard exists beyond you unless you have a standard giver that is there. In the third grade, I learned my times tables from Mrs. Velazquez. That is epistemology. That's how I know them. However, long before I existed, long before Mrs. Velazquez existed, the times tables were still there. That's ontology. Just because I came to know the times tables through my third grade teacher, that does not explain why they are true. Likewise, you can learn about morality in many different ways. But how do you explain that certain things are really right and other things are really wrong unless you have something that grounds you, a moral agent, a standard beyond ourselves by which we can compare? In summary, from the cosmological argument, we can see that the cause behind the universe must be spaceless, timeless, and immaterial because space, time, and matter came into existence at that point, and therefore the cause can't be made of space, time, and matter. He's also extremely powerful because he imbued all the usable energy that we have into our universe. From the teleological argument, we see that he is extremely intelligent. He put the universe and us together with extreme precision. From the moral argument, we see that he is absolutely morally perfect, and he's also personal. How do we determine from the moral argument that he's personal? Well, you only have a moral obligation to a person. You don't sin against impersonal forces. When you fly up in a plane, you're not sinning against the law of gravity. Because impersonal forces are impersonal. You can only sin against a person. We also know that he's personal from the cosmological argument, because impersonal forces don't choose to do anything. To go from a state of nothing to creation, someone had to make a choice. And only persons make choices. Notice that we have a need for a spaceless, timeless, immaterial, powerful, intelligent, moral, and personal creator. This is the God of biblical Christianity, identified without reference to the Bible. We have the God of the Bible, but we haven't opened the Bible other than to say that it's congruent with what the Bible says. Now, does this mean that Christianity is true? No, we still have a ways to go before we get there. But what we can say for now is that if our reasoning is solid to this point, we can say that if theism is true, that atheism and pantheism aren't true because of the law of non-contradiction. Two conflicting views cannot be true at the same time and in the same sense. If that's the case, then Judaism, Christianity, and Islam could all be true, as well as some other theism that we may not know about. If there's a theistic God out there, how could he communicate to us which one of these is true? He could do something that only he could do. And that would be a miracle. Next week, we'll dig into this question. Are miracles possible? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, you are powerful. You are beyond compare. Lord, you have shown yourself to us through your creation. You have revealed yourself and your majesty through all that you've given us. Lord, as we continue to seek answers in this world, I pray that you continue to journey alongside us, that you continue to open our minds, and that you continue to reveal yourself to us. Lord, thank you for the opportunity, the capacity that we have to discover who you are as you've revealed yourself to be. Lord, as we go from this place, as we go about our daily lives, may you be with us. May you be at the forefront of our mind. May we feel your presence and know that you are there with us. We pray this all in your precious and holy name, Lord. Amen.